Hi, my name is Steve Goodwin. Over the past several months, I've been conducting a series of anchor test setting videos. I've been posting these on YouTube, and maybe some of you have seen those, but if you haven't, you can go to my YouTube channel, SV Panope, and check them all out. The videos have come out pretty good. What I've done is I've used a small GoPro camera lashed to a float or float apparatus that's suspended or tethered to the anchors and suspended above. And the results have been pretty good. I've gotten some great footage of the anchors as they are setting. But before we get into that actual look at the anchors in action, I want to give a brief explanation of my anchor testing philosophy. I want to be very clear here that my testing is not meant to be a tutorial on proper anchoring technique. My goal has been to test these anchors' ability to set and reset in sort of a worst case scenario. So what's a worst case setting scenario? To me, it's open for interpretation, but to me, it means short scope, haphazard deployment, and uncontrolled boat motion during the set. Imagine being on a lee shore and having a power failure. There may be insufficient sea room for a long scope, little time for careful lowering of the anchor, and no way of stopping boat momentum. So for my test, that's exactly what I've tried to simulate. I toss the anchor overboard, let it free fall, and I back down on the boat at relatively high speed of about 2 knots during the anchor set. It is a purposely brutal test that exposes an anchor that has marginal setting ability. Okay, let's have a closer look at the 7 anchors that received the more thorough of my testing. First, we'll look at this 44-pound Mantis anchor. It actually came out on my scales at 40 pounds, and the weight on the tip in this position, let's call this the setting position, was 20 pounds. So it's got a very high ratio. It's 50% of the weight of the anchor is on the tip right now, and that tip is aggressively aimed downward, sharp angle, and it's a very sharp tip. Indeed, this anchor sets really, really fast. It's got this large roll bar, and the idea with that is if it's upside down, that'll just tend to let the anchor just rotate right on around into its setting position. The anchor's disassemblable. You see it's got bolts for the shank and the roll bar, so it would be a great anchor to stow. Part of this great weight distribution that puts so much weight on the tip and its rapid setting ability, I believe, lies in the fact that there's not a lot of weight in the shank. Now, anchor shanks will bend. It does happen even with the strongest anchors, and how strong an anchor shank needs to be is open to interpretation. But I have measured the dimensions of all these shanks at the point where I feel it would likely bend. I think for this anchor, that might be here at this area. And it is indeed quite thin and short in height, coupled with a very long lever arm. Next, we'll talk about this 48-pound Sarka XL anchor, and on my scales, it came out at 50 pounds. The tip came in at 10 pounds for a tip-to-total weight ratio of 20%. Notice that this anchor does not have a roll bar, so it relies on a weighted tip to orient itself into the setting position. This tip is actually just a solid steel. I believe they pour molten steel into that cavity. The anchor is very well made. I don't see any problem with the engineering. There's plenty of material in the shank, and the galvanizing is quite good. One little nitpick I have is that the anchor shackle attach point will accommodate this large shackle, but unfortunately this shackle is too big for my chain. I use 3/8 inch chain, and it requires the use of this 7/16 shackle. But unfortunately, that doesn't fit into the hole. It just can't go. So I'm forced to use 2 shackles. Again, it's not a really big deal. There's the orientation. Next, we'll talk about this 45-pound Manson Supreme. It actually came out at 47 pounds on my scale. So this is the anchor that I purchased about 4 years ago. I bought it secondhand, and this was to be and has been my primary anchor for my boat. It is an extremely strong anchor. I mentioned the anchor shank strength previously with the Mantis. This Manson Supreme anchor, the shank is really, really strong. It is quite a bit thicker than the Mantis, and it is much taller as well, and the lever arm is shorter. So altogether, this is an extremely robust built anchor. Total weight of the anchor is 47 pounds. The tip weight is 11 pounds, so it's pretty light on the tip. Let's say it's, I think it's 23% of the total weight of the anchor is on the tip. But let's look closer here. You can see that the actual point of the anchor is not touching the table. The point of contact's back here, and that's probably not an issue. Next, we'll talk about this 44-pound spade anchor. And according to my scale, it actually is 44 pounds. Tip weight came out at 18.5 pounds, so the tip to total weight percentage is about 42%. So it's pretty heavy on the tip, and we'll get down close. You'll see that the tip actually is touching the table at an aggressive angle. And in operation, it does work really well. This is a fine setting anchor. We talked about anchor shanks previously. This one is built a little different. The previous three anchors we talked about, the shanks are just made out of plate, just cut out and welded to their flukes. This anchor shank is somewhat triangular in cross section, so the underneath here is narrow and on the top here is wide. This is going to help setting because it's, you know, it's going to act like a knife and be able to penetrate the seabed better. The shank is hollow, so it's built up out of three pieces that are cut out and welded together. Of course, it's all ground out and galvanized, so you can't see that. It's made hollow, presumably, for this whole weight distribution thing and keeping the weight on the tip when it's setting. The other difference about this shank is it's removable. It fits into this slot here, and it's held in place by a bolt. So as far as strength goes, it's hard to get an apples-to-apples comparison. What I did, though, is I measured back about 23 inches and kind of arbitrary, kind of similar to these other anchor shank lengths, and did some measurements. And I averaged the width. So I took the top, took the bottom, and averaged it, and came up with a width that's actually wider than even the Manson. And it's got pretty good height to it, a little narrower than the Excel and the Manson. And we don't know what grade of metal this is. I don't think this is the higher strength as some of the others. But my gut feeling is it's pretty adequately strong. Now we'll look at this 33-pound Super Sarka anchor. This anchor, it's marketed as 33 pounds. It actually weighed out at 34 pounds on my scale. The tip weight came out at 11 pounds for a tip weight percentage of 33% of total. Get down close, you'll see that the tip is actually contacting the table at a pretty good angle. And this anchor in my testing, as you'll see, set very, very well. Anchor shank material is the same thickness as the Excel and the Mantis. Keep in mind, though, that this anchor is a whole notch or a whole category smaller. This would be the 33-pound size, where the others are in the mid-40-pound size. So it's not exactly apples to apples, but this shank has virtually identical dimensions as the larger Mantis, but it has quite a bit shorter lever arm. And then the whole anchor being smaller and therefore perhaps generating slightly less loads, I'm going to say that this shank is, should be in the middle of the pack somewhere. It's certainly not the strongest, but it's not the weakest. Next, we'll talk about this 44-pound Bruce anchor. It actually weighed out at 44 pounds on my scale, and the tip came out at 14 pounds and 32% of its total weight. And the way these guys set when they're not upright is a little different than the others. They actually start off almost upside down. And this is actually not likely. You'll see most of my testing, these things landed pretty much upright. But so this is the worst case scenario. But you can see you get quite a bit of weight here on this tip, and they do indeed set quickly. Last anchor we'll look at before we check out the actual anchor setting videos is this 10-pound Fortress anchor. They are made of aluminum. They're extremely well made, very precise machining and engineering. They perform exceptionally well in terms of holding power for their weight, perhaps the highest holding power per weight of any anchor anywhere.
Okay, let's dive right into these anchor videos. First test will be for the Excel anchor. Here's a typical deployment where I release things into the water. Here's the initial setting of the anchor. A little bit of turbidity here, but that kind of comes and goes in my test area. So we're at 3.5 to 1 scope with this first group of tests. We're in a seabed that consists of sandy mud. That was a nice initial set. Here's my reversal set. So the boat is driven up and over the anchor, 3.5 knots. Boat has come to an abrupt stop, and the anchor set nicely. You'll see the anchor comes up mostly clean, a little bit of seabed on the tip. Here is the Manson Supreme anchor. It is a very fast setting when it is clean, and we'll get into that later a little more. That's set very rapidly. Here's its rotation. Again, the boat's been driven up and overhead about 3.5 knots, and the anchor remained engaged in the seabed and stopped us abruptly. Note that amount of seabed attached to it. It's significant. Here's the 10-pound Fortress anchor. Good initial set. Stopped the boat. Here's the rotation. Can't really even see anything. The anchor stayed buried and, again, stopped the boat abruptly. I'm really trying to yank on these anchors hard, and, I want to expose some weaknesses. Here is the Spade anchor. It sets initially very hard. There's a crab running off to the right there. There's a chain whizzing by, so I just about nailed the reversal. Came right up over the anchor, and you'll see a real good swing here. Full 180 degrees. Anchor sets quickly and stops the boat. Again, these are all at 3.5 to 1 scope. And the retrieval, look at that. There's nothing on the anchor other than a piece of seaweed down there on the shank. So that came up real clean. Okay, here's the 44-pound Bruce anchor. This is a genuine Bruce, not a copy. Note that the heaping of seabed. That'll come up later, so keep an eye on that. It did set, though, and stopped the boat. And on its rotation, hard to see because of the sediment in the in the water, but it did stop the boat again, and look at that, it's perfectly clean, no sediment attached to it at all. This is the Mantis anchor. It consistently sets real hard. It just sort of knifes into the ground, and on the rotation, note that it stays completely upright, engaged in the seabed, and brings the boat to a quick halt. And it does have some seabed attached up near the tip, but the back part of the fluke is clean. Here's the Sarka anchor. It sets initially quite good. Very good, really. Some good pictures, a camera following it around. And on the reversal test, the anchor developed a tiny little list, but remained engaged with the seabed and stopped the boat immediately. And once again, we see some little bit of seabed attached to the tip, but the back part of the fluke was very clean. Okay, I've included this, I've included this anchor because of its dramatic failure. It never set. This is a 25-pound Danforth copy. It's not a genuine article, and again, I've included it because because of its dismal failure. This is a 65-pound four-fluorid anchor. They are common on commercial fishing boats in my area, and they do not develop high holding power for their weight, but they're probably a very good rock anchor or other specialty anchor. I keep it as a secondary in a hawse pipe on my bow. So here it is setting initially. It did good. Stopped the boat. And on the reset test, not a vigorous set or a reset and twist, but it did pivot, stayed engaged, and stopped the boat. Okay, this is a borrowed anchor. I only had it for one set of tests, and here we are. It is a 50-pound CQR anchor. It's doing what these anchors are known to do best, and that is they lay over on their side, and then you drag them around the anchorage in the hopes that they set. Eventually, this anchor did set, and when these anchors are set, they do develop pretty good holding power, but it's just marginal whether or not you can get them to really dig in. Here it is on the reversal test. And it breaks free, and off it goes for another lengthy drag. It's unknown whether this is a copy or a genuine CQR. I did note that the hinge pin was in good condition. This is a Bruce copy. This is probably the most heavily copied anchor out there. I don't know what brand this is. It did have some visible differences to my genuine Bruce anchor. Just looking at it, the toe was thicker, and it failed to set. I was able to continuously drag it with my boat in just in reverse thrust, which is only a couple hundred pounds of thrust. So that was a big failure. The warning is to beware of copy anchors. This is a genuine Danforth anchor. It's a 20-pounder, and it sets initially quite well. These develop real high holding power when they're set. And here it is on the reversal. Notice it's developed a list to the left. It did drag for a while, but it eventually, you'll see here, let's watch what happens. And taking off, pulling it again in reverse. The anchor is listing. Kind of spotty performance. Sometimes it hooked up good and sometimes it didn't. So here it finally does rotate almost level and stops the boat. This is a 40-pound Luke copy. Luke anchors are a disassemblable version of the old-fashioned fisherman anchor, and this anchor failed to set. It's not a challenging seabed. Again, we're still at that sandy mud site. What you see is what you get. It never sets. Here's a 100-pound fisherman anchor. This is the real McCoy, and you'll see we're using nylon road, no chain, and that's what was recommended back in the day, and it does set, and it is indeed hold the boat in reverse thrust of about 300 pounds of pressure. Okay, now we're going to go back and we're going to retest the core good 7 anchors at 2-to-1, reduced scope. This first test of the Manson was at 2.8-to-1 scope, and it did set initially very well. And once again, on the reversal, it appeared to rotate in the seabed and stay hooked up, but once I added some reverse power, off she goes. And in this instance, the anchor failed altogether to reset. I drug it for, many, many dozens of feet. So I thought that could be an anomaly. But first here, we'll look at the seabed. Note that the seabed is not attached to the tip. It's more back in the back of the fluke. So here I am. I'm retesting the anchor, this time at 2.5-to-1 scope. Maybe that was an anomaly. But sure enough, it sets initially perfectly. And then on the reset, becomes disengaged from the seabed, and off it goes for another very lengthy drag. Now note here, coming up we're going to see, especially if you can view this in high definition, you might see a fairly large blob of seabed. Here it is. It's just settled right in there. The anchor's over on its side, and it eventually did reset, but with great difficulty. And here we see a fairly significant blob of seabed. That time it was actually attached to the toe as well as the back of the fluke. Here is the Fortress anchor. Again, we're at the same anchorage area. It is a sandy mud composition, 2.5-to-1 scope, and the anchor struggled, but it eventually did set. And on the reset, another lengthy drag, and it eventually set it. Here's the Spade anchor at 2.5-to-1 scope. That's just almost an immediate setting. Here's the reverse. You can see the chain arcing around. Anchor pivots, drags maybe 1, 2, I don't even think it was 3 anchor lengths, and brought the boat to an abrupt halt. Here it is on the retrieval. Initially it has a pretty good amount of seabed, but it flushes away pretty quickly, and you could see a bit of the tip showing there. Here's the 33-pound Bruce at 2.5-to-1 scope. I didn't test the 44-pound Bruce, but those anchors really behave quite similarly. The anchor struggles at this really short scope, but it does eventually set. Keep in mind, these short scopes really are not recommended. I'm doing these short scopes for test purposes only. And here we are dragging along. The anchor has a list. You'll see here at the top of the screen, that's the right-hand fluke it is showing. But the anchor did eventually reset and did hold. So at this point, I haven't had any trouble with the Bruce anchors. They're doing just fine. Here's the retrieval. It's got a little bit of seabed attached, but not much. Now the Excel anchor at 2.5-to-1 scope. We're still at the sandy mud composition bottom. Another nice quick set. Flukes just penetrate nicely. There's never any heaping with this anchor. Here's the reset. Unfortunately, we don't get to see too much because of that turbidity, but the anchor did release. And yeah, it took a little bit longer, maybe 3 or 4 anchor lengths, but it definitely brought the boat to an abrupt halt. And here it is, we don't see it, but it's continuing to hold the boat. Here's the retrieval. We see a blob of seabed on the toe, but the back part of the flukes are clean. The cutouts in the fluke, the name, the XL, that's believed to alleviate or allow the seabed to release. Here is the mantis at 2.5 to 1 scope. Note the chain is up off the seabed, quite a good angle. And once again, this anchor has a strong tendency to remain upright, remain engaged, and rotate. Here we see seabed attached to the tip only. The back part of the seabed was clear. Here's the sarca anchor. Once again, we're at 2.5 to 1 scope in a sandy mud composition bottom. Initial set was great. Unfortunately, we have some turbidity. There's the reset. Camera's kind of jammed into the bottom, but there it pops up and we get a good view. The anchor is perfectly upright and reset. Once again, boat was brought to an abrupt halt. Here it is on the retrieval, and we see a little, just a tiny bit of seabed attached to the front of the anchor. Again, this anchor has cutouts, and we believe the water being able to access the seabed from the backside will help flush that seabed clean. It seems to work. This anchor and the XL, neither one of them have any problem with clogging or resetting with seabed attached. Okay, that concludes the first set of tests at my sandy mud composition bottom, and I think there's two takeaways that I conclude here. And the first one is that the copy anchors, these are, you know, the anchors that are not the genuine original anchors, they consistently had a problem setting. They ranged from being marginal to basically useless. So beware of copy anchors. That's one takeaway. And the other was that the Manson Supreme anchor appears to collect more seabed than other anchors, and when it does have seabed collected to it, it has trouble resetting. The anchor is perfect when it's clean, so initial sets are very fast, rapid, and the anchor develops extremely high holding power. But beware, when the anchor releases with seabed attached, you may have problems. So here's the next test site. This is the sand and gravel site. The area has a lot of current, so there's not much turbidity, so we get good pictures. Here's the Manson with the chain attached to the rock slot. Note that the chain is slid to the tripping end of the rock slot. So this is the initial set, and the anchor's dragging along on its side, kind of sideways. And until the chain and shackle travel to the correct end, or the setting end, which it's done here, there's no chance for it to set. Now that would be alleviated with careful setting, so let's give that a pass. But here it is, it's dragging on another 3 or 4 anchor lengths, and then it sets nicely. Once again, though, here we are on the reset, so I'm driving the boat, and here's the chain whizzing by. We're going 180-degree reset test, and listen carefully. Got her in slow motion. That sliding sound was the shackles traveling in the slot, and indeed, it's doing just what it's supposed to do. It's causing the anchor to release. Anchor releases from the seabed, and immediately the shackle travels back to the correct end, but the damage has been done. The anchor fails to reset. Now on the retrieval, you'll see here we've got a whole bunch of weeds and rocks. There's actually weeds are connected to rocks with roots, and for whatever reason, maybe it's the weight distribution or the physical impeding of the tip, that anchor did not reset. So once again, it's a problem with clogging. Here I've retested the anchor. This time I've just got the chain attached to the normal hull, so the rock slot is not being employed, and the anchor works fine. It was clean, and it reset perfectly. Here on the rotation, it's kind of a mild rotation because the current prevented me from positioning the boat for a real good 180-degree turn. Anyway, the anchor remained engaged the seabed and did not release and stop the boat. Here is the spade anchor. Again, we're at the sand and rock location. We're at 3.5 to 1 scope. The anchor sets immediately. It disappears, and unfortunately, we didn't get to see anything on this gentle reset. Chain and anchor were buried. Here's the XL at 3.5 to 1 scope, sand and gravel site. Sets immediately. I don't see any heaping. Here's the rotation. Often the camera became jammed into the seabed here. but we can see that the anchor sat and the boat did stop the boat quickly. Here's some great footage of the mantis. We got the camera following it all the way around. It sets rapidly, and once again, this anchor remains mostly engaged with the seabed, did not tip over onto its side, and stops the boat. Here's the Sarka, showing some deployment action again. Still at that same sand-gravel combination site. The current is just dragging the boat backwards here, so it's not as vigorous of a set, but the anchor does set. And on the reversal, again the camera gets fouled, but it eventually pops up and I think we'll see that it's set. Here's the Fortress anchor at three. Keep in mind that the Fortress anchor manufacturer states that you should not use less than 5-to-1 scope for their anchors. So here we are at 3.5-to-1 scope, and it's struggling. The anchor does take quite a while to set, but you can see here in the aftermath it was actually buried and it set pretty good. Here it is on the 180 degree reset. Unfortunately, our images are obscured. I'm going to let the camera roll here though, because you can see part of the camera apparatus is partially fouling the anchor. I don't know if that had any effect or not. Okay, this is the same test site, but a new sequence. All we've done here is we're going to retest all the anchors at 2.5-to-1 scope. Again, we're at the sand and rock location. That was the Manson. Initial set was good. And on the 180-degree reset, the anchor did release. Drags an unknown distance, but no more than, say, 4 or 5 lengths, and a perfect reset. Here's deployment of the spade. Again, we're at short scope here, 2.5-to-1 scope, sand and gravel location. Perfect initial set. Looks like it just releases from the seabed and get a nice reset. Stop the boat. Here's the Excel at 2.5-to-1. Sand and gravel combination seabed. This seabed's not particularly uniform. Some areas have more sand and other areas have more gravel. So that's unfortunate. It's really best to have a uniform seabed. So here's the reset. Now watch, we're slow motion. This anchor does not pivot. It's going to get flipped up over backwards. So no doubt it landed on its back, but we don't get to see it. But clearly the anchor has rotated back upright, because just after a very short drag and immediate stopping of the boat, we see the anchor there set with its shank upright. Here's the Mantis. Again, 2.5-to-1 scope. Sand and gravel site. Note the chains up off from the bottom there. And once again, this anchor really likes to stay level. It almost released, but it really didn't. It stayed engaged and rotates and stops the boat. Now here's the Sarka. And see that big boulder there? Well, fist-sized rock. I'm not quite sure if this failure here... okay, let's not call it a failure. The anchors are struggling. But it never did stop the boat. It kept on moving. Note there's some more rocks there in the lower right of the screen. And I'm not sure if we're just beyond the capability of the anchor. Primarily, you know, are we at a scope that it just can't cope with? Or was there just bigger rocks here? It's unknown. I'm not going to call this a failure by any means. Again, it's very challenging here. We've got big rocks and we've got really short scope. At the just a little bit more scope, that anchor did fine, but at the 2.5, it was struggling. Here's the Fortress at 2.5-to-1 scope, and once again, the Fortress people say not to use less than 5-to-1. So we're really out of bounds here of what's recommended. I certainly don't recommend people anchor at these short scopes. So here the camera is jammed into the seabed. It's kind of digging a little furrow along. So the anchor's kind of set, but the boat's still moving. Okay, so here's the reset test. Once again, in slow motion, we see the anchor being upended, up and over. The anchor actually gets airborne. It's flying along. It does a half barrel roll and recontacts the seabed. And I'll let the tape roll here because some interesting things happen. Watch closely here on just to the right of the anchor. We're going to pick up a hitchhiker. There it is. We'll see more of that on the retrieval. So we've got lots collected, lots of stuff. And here I'm freeing all that, and there's our hitchhiker. That turned out to be a small tree. That was jammed in the fluke, and it certainly would have rendered the pivoting action of the anchor inoperative. But even perhaps even worse, we'll see, here's a rock, and it's jammed in between the flukes. The flukes converge toward each other, and the only way to get the rock out was to pull it out the way it came. Once again, that would have prevented the anchor pivoting action from moving. Okay, so this is a load cell tester. One end of the load cell to the boat, and the other end's a chain to the dock, and you can see the significant prop wash there. I've got the boat in forward thrust, full ahead, and I've averaged out about 910 pounds. That's significant for this next series of tests. So we're back at the sand and mud site, and what the idea here is to set them as hard as I can. That's the spade being retrieved after being fully buried. Here's the Excel. We don't get to see it, but it was mostly buried as well. Just a bit of the shank was exposed. Lots of turbidity in those first two images. So here's the mantis. We've got nice clear water this time, and so that's the initial set. Here were medium power and high power. It's a really large hoop, so we don't actually bury the whole anchor, but it certainly didn't take long. It buried the fluke completely, and it was very difficult to retrieve. Here's the 10-pound fortress anchor. Again, this is all at 3.5 to 1 scope, sandy mud bottom. So there's medium power, there's 750 pounds of thrust, and max thrust of 910, but the anchor just kept moving. It never stopped. So I used the recommended scope by the manufacturer of 5 to 1 and redid the test. Here we are at 750 pounds of thrust. It's not moving. And then 910 pounds of thrust. No movement, so that's real good. That was a 10-pound anchor, by the way, holding almost 1,000 pounds. Here's the Sarka anchor, initial set. Medium power. There's 750 pounds of thrust, and full power, 910 pounds of thrust. Anchor is virtually buried. Just a tiny bit of the roll bar was exposed, and very difficult on the retrieval. There's the deployment of the Manson Supreme. Setting after it spun around, and here we are at max thrust. Quite a bit of debris and turbidity, so we didn't get to see much of that one, and everything was covered except the back of the roll bar on the Manson. Now this is a very interesting test, perhaps my most revealing images of my whole anchor testing. This is a 44 pound genuine Bruce anchor. Here we are at medium power, higher power, 750 pounds. Now notice that there's heaping going on. Almost like the bottom is being extruded up and over the fluke of the anchor, and the anchor does not want to penetrate. I drug it, and we watch it, and it doesn't go down. It actually comes up. We're not at max power. We're at three-quarter power, roughly, at 750 pounds of thrust. Anchor released from the seabed, and to me, that's a boat on the rocks. So I tried it again, this time with 5-to-1 scope, and it does better, but here we are at max thrust. It's holding somewhat, but it's actually moving now. I leave the power in. Once again, the anchor is not diving into the seabed. Now, these anchors are known to not produce as high a holding power as other anchors for their weight, and the theory has been that it's due to the flukes being too small. But my theory is that the problem is the anchors just won't dive. I don't know why. I mean, it's a seabed geometry scientific question that I don't have an answer to, but apparently the Bruce anchor developers didn't have the answer either, at least in this size range. I believe the larger Bruce anchors do not suffer from this problem, but again, at this size range, that's a major flaw. Here we are with the big 65 pound forward anchor with this same so-called deep set test. Here we are at 300 pounds, 500 pounds. Once again, this is not a diving anchor. It tends to heap. Lots of debris in front of it. And here we are at max thrust. I thought it was going to do good from the boat. I couldn't tell things were moving. But it is moving, and you notice it's rotating, and that's the right-hand fluke point there. So the anchor is corkscrewing, and it releases. Off it goes.
Okay, if you've seen all my anchor videos that I've created, or at least good portions of them, and maybe you've made some decisions about what you think is the best anchor. And I think that's really the bottom line. I've tried to present my material in a way that you don't have to listen to my opinions and my analysis. However, many people have asked me, well, Steve, which anchor are you going to keep? What's the best anchor? What are you going to put on your boat? And I'm reluctant to even offer that, because it's as you'll see, it's going to all come down to a kind of subjective decision. But well, you guys asked, so here you go. I'll go right down the line. The Fortress anchor. This is a keeper. It is not going to be my bow anchor. It is going to be disassembled and it's going to be stored down below, and that's going to be my rowable, walkable stern type anchor. It's great. Bruce, oh, I'd love to keep this anchor. I wish there was a way that I could fit it onto my bow. I think it's the best looking anchor that I could possibly choose. Lots going for it, but it's got that major flaw, just low holding power. So no to the Bruce. Sarka is a very cool anchor. It's undersized though. It's one or perhaps two notches too small for my boat. And if it was bigger, this would be a really difficult decision. But because it is the size it is, I don't have to make the decision. It's just too small, and no to the Sarka. Spade's a fantastic anchor. It's beautiful. Perfect performance in my testing. I really want to say yes to the Spade right now, and I'm not going to say no either. Let's just put that aside. The Manson, boy, this could be the best anchor, but it just isn't. It's got that clogging issue that it may be very rare, but it's there. There's other anchors that just don't clog, so I'm going to choose those instead of the Manson. It's super strong, and I like strong things, but yeah, no to the Manson. Another anchor that's really, really, really difficult to say no to, and I'm not going to say no yet, just yet. It's fantastic. It's strong. It works perfectly. It's an absolutely magnificent anchor. Arguably, you could say that this is the best anchor on the table. We'll come back to it. The Mantis. Easily the fastest setting and most reliable setting anchor on the table, maybe in the world. And if it was just that, it'd be a no-brainer. This is the anchor. It is just too weak looking for my taste. I like strong things. I like robust, beefy looking stuff, and it just is too spindly looking. And it may be too spindly in operation for my needs. I'm not sure. What am I going to do with this anchor? I'm going to keep it. I'm going to keep it disassembled and in the bilge. It'll make a perfect backup for when and if my primary bow anchor is lost or somehow I don't have it anymore. So it's a no for the bow, but it's a yes for keeping it in the bilge. So, okay, which is it, Excel or Spade? And here's where subjectivity comes in. My boat's got lots of curves on it. Curved handrails, got a big sweeping sheer. It's just full of curves, and so is this Spade, and it matches and it fits good on there, and I just like the way it looks. The Excel looks great. It's an angular design. You can see it's got angles instead of curves all over it, and there's nothing wrong with that kind of shape. But unfortunately, my boat doesn't have angles. It's a curvy boat, and I know it's silly, but I'm going to say no to the Excel just because of the way it looks. So there you go. I like the Spade. I guess I'm a Spade anchor man now until something better comes along. There you have it. Okay, you've managed to sit through a lot of talking about anchors, perhaps too much. I sure enjoyed doing the project. I felt it was important to produce this last kind of a summary video to kind of wrap things up. It's certainly a lot of time involved in executing all the tests. It's really been fun for me. I enjoy boating. I enjoy handling equipment. Perhaps the best part of it, though, for me was developing the camera system, the mount and the float, and that rig that kind of follows the anchor around visually, even when it's moving. That was all very rewarding for me. And I hope for you, you can maybe make some good anchor decisions about the gear that you have and maybe the gear that you purchase in the future. Anyway, safe anchoring, and thanks for watching. I'm Steve Goodwin. So long. So, hey Emma, which one of these anchors is your favorite? And I see maybe you've written down some things as to why, so maybe I'll read those. It says here that you like it because it looks like a Star Wars ship, and you can steer it, and it looks like a shovel.